Hello, horseheads and banjo players and all the ships at sea, and welcome to A Very Good Year, the movie podcast where we invite a guest to pick their favorite year of movies and talk to us all about that year. I'm your host, Jason Bailey, and across the mic and across the country from me is my co-host,
Michael Hull.
Our guest today is an acclaimed production designer whose numerous credits include several fine films, including Carol, I'm Not There, Brokeback Mountain, We Need to Talk About Kevin, which just came up last week, Garden State, The Fighter, Silver Linings Playbook, and American Hustle, for which she was nominated for a little something called the Academy Award. She is also the subject of the newest Filmcraft series put on by our friends at the Metrograph Theater here in New York City. That starts on June 3rd. Folks, say hi to Judy Becker. Hi, Judy.
Hi.
Thank you so much for doing this. This is so exciting for us.
It's exciting for me, too. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Well, you are our very first production designer guest.
Wow, that's cool. Yeah.
Yeah, we've had, you know, some cinematographers, we've had filmmakers, actors, lots of film critics and writers.
Lots.
But you are lots. Those are the people that I can DM on Twitter easily to get to be guests. But I think even some of us who pride ourselves as knowledgeable about film, who write even about film, only have kind of a tenuous grasp on what exactly a production designer does. So for those who don't know, how do you describe the job of a production designer?
It's not an original description, but I heard someone say it, and I think it captures it perfectly, which is I create the world that the movie takes place in. And that's in an abstract way. In the concrete way, I design the sets, I help pick the locations, I work on the color palette, the look of the movie, the look of the world that the movie's happening in. And rarely, unless it's a documentary, do they happen in the actual real world. So that's a right. world that the production designer, along with other craftsmen, has to create.
Yeah. So it sounds like it's sort of a position that requires immense creativity and also very hands-on skills, and also being able to like collaborate with a lot of different people.
All of those things. Yeah. It's a collaboration is a big part of it. You're collaborating with the director and the producers to an extent, and the cinematographer and the costume designer, but then you're also collaborating with your own team, my art yeah. director, my set decorator, my construction coordinator. So it's a collaboration on two ends, but equally important on both ends, I would say. A lot of people skills involved. That's probably my weakest point, but the hands-on and the imagination I'm good at. So.
Also, I would think a sort of deep observation, like something like Brokeback Mountain is not just out of sort of most of our locations that we walk around and spend our lives in, but also out of time. And I yeah. think that sort of deep observation of what surrounds us is something that I don't think anybody but production designers and like maybe oil painters are really sort of approaching that level of observational detail.
And that really does describe not the oil painting part, but I observe everything. Streets I've walked down every single day, I will always notice something new, not the people because they're always different, but like a thing. Sure. And I remember I was once with my sister in an parking garage in Chicago. And I was just looking at the signage and thinking, that's cool looking. I'm going to take a photograph of that. And at that very moment, she said, isn't this place hideous? It's just awful. And I was thinking like, there's just different ways of seeing, you know.
Well, I want to talk real briefly about this Filmcraft series over at Metrograph, because what they do with these series that I think is awesome is that they have each of the subjects sort of select a handful of their own films and then pair them with a film that is a particular inspiration to them and maybe even to that particular picture. And so yeah. I would love to talk just real quick about sort of why you picked each of these pairings.
Yeah.
Because first of all, they're screening I'm Not There, which you designed for Todd Haynes, which is maybe my favorite biopic of all time, because it's like, fuck the biopic. And I can't not love that.
Yeah.
And I'm also a huge Dylan person, but yeah. But you paired it with Last Picture Show. Tell me about that pair up.
I mean, it was partly orneriness on my part because Last Picture Show would be an obvious pairing with Brokeback Mountain, but it actually wasn't the movie I was thinking about when I first approached Brokeback Mountain, but it's still been hugely influential on me, and I've been thinking about it. What is it about that movie? And I think that a big part of it is that it was a period movie made in the 70s, but takes place in the 50s. And I always forget that. I mean, I've seen it a bunch of times. And I think that because it feels like we're in that world at that time, it doesn't feel, you know, period in quotes. And that's what I really strive for in my work. I've done a lot of period movies now, and Brokeback was my first, but it's like my specialty now. And, but I always try to make it feel real, you know, like we could be there. Like it feels like a real world to us and not a sepia toned image of the past. So it's something that I don't always aim for that, but most of the time you want it to feel vital and real, and like those are real people and they're not like imaginary mythic figures. So I think that's the reason. It's a long answer, but I think that's the big reason. And it's got a nice minimalism and like a very refined approach to the imagery. It's not overstuffed or anything, but
right.
I think the fact that I always forget that it's a period film is the real reason.
Yeah. Right. Cause it's so incredibly lived in.
Yeah.
So then the film that you paired with Brokeback Mountain was Walkabout.
Yeah. Yeah. And then, now, I mean, to
and
me,
why that one?
I thought of it right away when I read the script, because Walkabout, you know, it's about two teenagers. I don't even know if they're both teenagers that are stranded in the wilderness. And most of the movie takes place in that wilderness, and it's a coming of age story and many, many things. But at the end, there's a flash forward and you see the girl as an adult in what looks like a high rise apartment building, and everything's beige and gray. And it looks horrible. I mean, really horrible, depressing. It's a depressing ending, I think. And you know what's going through her head, that she's remembering those times, and it's that she will never have again. And that's so much of what Brokeback is about. It's about the freedom that Jack and Ennis find in nature and that they can't achieve in real life, in real life society at that time, at that period of history. So it was really... It was definitely the first movie I thought of in terms of the contrast between the natural world and the socialized world. And Aang had never seen it.
You got to bring a movie to him.
That's, I did. That was
badass.
Yeah. Yeah, he's pretty much badass. Seen everything. So yeah, it's like, yeah,
I love that.
Yeah,
I love that. And then the third pairing is we need to talk about Kevin with Rosemary's Baby.
Yeah. And that's a little more straightforward because it's something I talk about fairly often, that you have to, if there's anything that's kind of over the top that's going on in a movie, I like to balance it with something very grounded in reality. And I think the best horror films do that, and the best, I don't know, magical realism, or anything that involves a degree of the supernatural or of the magical, or of like over the top behavior. Even I think you need to balance it, or it just becomes about the superficial things and not about what the story's really about. So what I love in Rosemary's Baby, every time I watch it, which is quite often, is like often as it'll play at the Metrograph, I'll go see it. And is how relatable it still is. I mean, you know, she goes down, you know, Upper East Side, going to her doctor. It looks like how it would look now. And, you know, they're a young couple. They happen to have a really, really nice apartment. So that's not maybe so grounded in reality for most of us, but that's luck. I mean, it's witchcraft that got them that apartment. And their neighbors are so annoying and banal, and just like the neighbors that you really are just like, you don't want to have to hang out with them, but you're being nice, so you do. And that's what's so clever about the book, I assume. But the movie is that it draws you in that way, just the way the characters are drawn in through, you know, it's not like there's cobwebs on their door, you know, and a big sign saying keep out Castanets. I can't remember their name, but so it's that balance of the real and the supernatural. And in Kevin, you know, it's about this pretty screwed up murderous kid and Kevin. And so even though we took things a little over the top at times, they live in a suburban house, and it was so important to me to like have like these ugly plastic toys all over the place in that house, because that's what happens when you have kids, you know, like there's plastic yep. toys everywhere unless you're really, really like a design freak who just forbids them to enter the house. So, and you know, we took it a little to the extreme, in certain ways with the color palette, and, but it's still like a suburban house with a lot of plastic in it. And that was sort of my, my way of grounding it in a familiar reality.
That's great. Well, this is a spectacular trio of double bills. Let's talk a little bit about what we're going to talk about tonight. What year
Not
did you
Kevin.
Pick? Hey, look what you did.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, go ahead.
What year did you pick for your very good year, and why did you pick it?
Well, as soon as I got the invitation and I looked at the list, I was like, damn, all the years from the 70s are gone. What am I going to do? You know? And the truth is, I would have picked 1976 because that's the year my absolute favorite movie, Taxi Driver, came out. But it was already taken by someone who didn't even include Taxi Driver, just going to say. And then there were some mysterious years that had like these initials and nothing else. And I said, are those years available? And they were. And I chose 1972, not because of The Godfather, but because of Fat City, which is one of my favorite movies. And
nice.
Yeah, that's why.
All right. Well, we're going to talk about both of those and three more spectacular 1972 movies. But before we do, Mike is going to fill us in on what was happening in the world around the movie theater in 1972. Here's headlines.
The organizers of this civil rights march promised that this people would be non-violent. The army have said throughout the day that they hope to use minimum force. But 3 hours after the procession began, this has ended up, as dusk comes onto the Bogside, as the worst ever confrontation between the army and the Catholic people of the Cragan and Bogside.
All right, the year started off strong. Started off with some big news. The British Army on January 30th killed 14 unarmed marchers in Derry, Northern Ireland. Most of our audience probably first heard about this event in the typically melodramatic U2 song Sunday Bloody Sunday, but there are tons of films and docs that touch on it. And even though they don't really talk about it, it's just an excuse to tell everybody to watch Derry Girls, because it happened in Derry. And Derry Girls is great.
So is Paul Greengrass's Bloody Sunday, which is a very intensely visceral docudrama style recreation of that day. Good picture.
As he does.
Yeah, there was a lot of the Troubles were at their peak in 72. So there was a lot. That's the only one we're going to touch on. But that was happening all year long. Yeah. On February 2nd, actually, the British Embassy in Dublin was burned to the ground. So that was the other point we touch on as far as that goes. On March 22nd, it was a big day for the U.S. government, slowly dragging itself into the present. Congress sent the proposed Equal Rights Amendment to the states for ratification, which did not happen. Almost. It was very close.
God damn it.
It was like two states away.
Still hasn't.
Yep.
Also that day was the release of the Supreme Court decision in Eisenstadt versus Baird that guaranteed single people the right to buy birth control.
Well, thank goodness we're in no danger of that ever getting rolled back. That one, at least that's safe. At least that's safe forever.
Settled that in 72?
Yep, settled business.
It was illegal before then?
It was, you had to be married and like have a marriage certificate. And I mean, you know, depending on how shitty your pharmacist wanted to be, but
Okay.
And it was in some states, you know, New York was, I mean, like with many other things, New York was a little looser, right? But yeah, that was when the Supreme Court made it nationwide.
Amazing.
Sounds insane, but here we are.
Yeah.
In April, the U.S., the Soviet Union, and more than 50 other countries signed the Biological Weapons Convention and agreed not to use biological weapons on each other, which seems like a low bar.
Yeah.
But we finally crossed it.
Yeah.
Yay.
Yeah.
In May was the SALT I Treaty when we tried to do something about all the missiles.
Again,
very similar.
all these situation. Problems are taken care of now. All went away.
Yeah, it's just amazing how that happens.
In June, a bunch of morons got busted burgling the DNC offices at the Watergate Hotel in Washington, D.C., coining a phrase that is shorthand for fuckery to this day.
Wait, I'm not familiar with this, Mike. You said Watergate?
Yeah, it's a hotel.
Okay,
yeah,
I'm gonna do some Googling. I'll get back to you on this.
Okay, great.
You go ahead. Yeah. I'll read up.
In July was the first rainbow gathering. And if you don't know what that is, you didn't smoke enough pot in college.
I don't know what it is.
I guess nobody here smoked enough pot in college.
I'm still Googling, Mike.
This is an ITN newsflash from the Olympic Village in Munich, where early this morning, armed Palestinian guerrillas raided the sleeping quarters of the Israeli team. The gunmen shot dead two Israelis and are now holding 20 athletes and 6 officials as hostages. The guerrillas are demanding the release of 250 Arabs held prisoner in Israel and have set noon as the deadline for their release. Negotiations are going on with the German government.
Also that summer was the 1972 Munich Olympics, which ceased to be a sports story when the Black September organization killed 11 Israeli athletes and coaches and one West German security guard. There have been several movies about that as well, and some of them are good.
Nixon wins by a knockout without ever leaving his corner. The only man in the world to go down for the third time and live to fight again and win twice. And that's really tricky. 3 cheers for a gallant winner. And in the loser's corner, champion shadow boxer Senator George McGovern. Like he said, how can you fight a man who talks about peace all the time? They say that Nixon won because McGovern lost. How else?
In the fall, Richard Nixon was reelected president in a landslide, but literally did not spend 1 minute happy about it or anything else.
Okay, Mike, I finished my Googling, and this Nixon fellow, this Watergate, man, this was bad business.
Bad news.
Yeah, I don't think he should have gotten reelected if that was happening. This is a little shocking.
Have you ever heard the story of what he did the night he got reelected?
No, I haven't.
He sat in the private quarters of the White House and wrote a list of all the things that were wrong with him. Like, when I tell you this man didn't enjoy one fucking minute, I mean, not 1 minute.
That's like my typical Friday night. Is that a weird thing to do?
Company you keep. In November was the last 2 executions in Paris when Roger Bontemps and Claude Buffet were killed by a fucking guillotine.
Oh my God.
1972, baby. The past is not as far away as we think it was.
They kept it real. Kept it real to the end.
Yeah. Also that month, the Mellow Yellow opened in Amsterdam and started their coffee shop culture. And if you don't know what that is, you didn't smoke enough pot in college.
This is homecoming day for Apollo 17, the last round trip to the moon that Americans may take in this century. In less than an hour, the astronauts will be back with perhaps what may be the most valuable cargo ever delivered in space. The spacecraft that lands in the Pacific will have traveled nearly 1.5 million miles without getting so much as a flat tire.
And in December was the Apollo 17 mission, the final manned mission to the moon, when the astronaut fellows drove my grandpa's buggy for the last time. So that's pretty sweet.
Heads up. Yay.
And here's a fun fact about 1972. It's the only year where they added not only a leap day, but 2 leap seconds, making it, they call it, the longest year in history at 366 days and 2 seconds. But like, how long have we been counting the leap thing? It seems like longest year in history is a bit of a dramatic title.
I picked the longest year.
I was going to say, that's why there were so many good movies in 72. Yeah. They had more year to put them out. Yeah.
More time for more exploitation films. So
there you go.
The daytime edition of The Price is Right debuted in 72. So that's obviously good.
Wait, yep, there was a nighttime edition?
There was a prime time when like prime time game shows were sort of the last time that was a thing before, you know, the version about 10 years ago. It was not hosted by Bob Barker. He brought in the morning edition, the daytime side. And that's the one I grew up on anyway.
You should have led with that story.
It is the best, most positive story we've had so far.
Definitely.
The Joy of Sex was published for the first time in 72.
Yay!
That seems like a good thing, obviously. Yeah. Lots of people died in 72, but the only one we're going to mention is the not in a not at all celebratory way. Not at all. J. Edgar Hoover fucking died. Finally, rest in piss.
Big hand for the Grim Reaper, everybody. Big hand.
That's right, yeah.
Give it up for the Grim Reaper. Finally getting J. Edgar out of here.
That guy was not doing any good by then. Nope. Some people were born in 72. Wrestler Big Show, pro surfer Kelly Slater, Billy Joe Armstrong, and Trey Cool from Green Day. Comedian Ralphie May, Shaquille O'Neal, rapper Common, American soccer great Mia Hamm, Jennifer Garner, and her perpetually dissatisfied ex Ben were both born in 72. Busta Rhymes, Octavia Spencer, Laverne Cox, Manny Ramirez, Wayne Brady, Zinedine Zidane, Lisa Leslie. So many cool people are turning 50. Mm-hmm. Or turned 50 last year, I guess. Leslie Mann, yep. Maya Rudolph, Cameron Diaz, Idris Elba. The list goes on.
Yeah, those last four, that's my dream blunt rotation. Leslie Mann, Maya Rudolph, Cameron Diaz, Idris Elba.
Yeah, that's an excellent Saturday. Eminem, Gabrielle Union, Alyssa Milano, and finally, the notorious B.I.G.
Rest in peace,
Big Papa.
Didn't turn 50.
There was no World Cup in 72, and although lots of sporting events took place, the only sports story that matters from 1972 is the death of professional baseball player Roberto Clemente, who died in a plane crash taking relief supplies to Nicaragua. Mm. By all accounts, a genuine mensch. That's headlines.
All right. Thank you, Mike. Judy Becker, you ready to do a top five?
I am.
Yeah, Judy has requested that we do a random ranking selected by us.
Yes.
That we throw one out. There you go. Yeah. We can't just turn the show over for 25. Nah. We gotta select carefully. So I am gonna start with the movie that everybody thinks about when they think of the year 1972, presumably, and that's a little Francis Ford Coppola picture called The Godfather.
Yes.
Michael, do you renounce Satan and all his works?
I do renounce him.
Don't ask me about my business, Kate.
Is it true?
Leave the gun. Take the cannoli.
Now, this is a movie it's hard to say new things about, but Judy, you're incredibly tuned into this world. You're a brilliant woman. I'm sure you have some new and profound insight into the world of The Godfather to share with us.
Oh, yeah. Well, I can't believe that actually Marlon Brando played both The Godfather and the guy in Last Tango in Paris.
In the same year.
Yeah, because he looks a lot older and fatter in The Godfather, right? And yes. I was just rewatching Last Tango today and I'm like, wait a second. Like, how did that happen? How do you do that? So first of all, there's that. And then I could get serious and talk about like both the anti-hero that is The Godfather and the hero that becomes the villain that is Michael Corleone. But he doesn't become truly villainous until Godfather 2, I think, when he kills Fredo or has him killed. But but that's, you know, that the story of the anti-hero is something that fascinates me. And I really think the 70s was a great time for that. So hence The Godfather. And it's absolutely a beautifully, perfectly crafted movie in every way.
Tell us a little bit about it from a production design perspective, because that is one thing we don't hear much about.
I guess this is the time to say that if I really love a movie, most of the time I don't notice the design, and because the design is working in the way that it should. So I remember scenes in The Godfather. I mean, I did not rewatch that movie recently because I've seen a gazillion times. But you know, it looks great, but every minute of it is believable. Like, you never question that. Though, I mean, who knows how people like The Godfather don't really exist, but if they did, who knows how they really live? Probably more like Tony Soprano than like that, but you never question it. It just looks right. It looks right every step of the way. The shitty apartment that Sonny lives in, like, it all looks just right. And it's not overdone and it's not too over the top, but it's you know, it's not, they don't live in the Bronx, for example, sorry, you know, but I live close to the Bronx too. Like, they all live in a shitty apartment in the Bronx. So they, it just looks right. Like, this is what you do. You don't overspend it, but you have a nice life and people come to your office and ask you for favors. So
yeah,
it looks, and then the music, we all know it by heart, and it's gorgeous looking. It's shot beautifully. But all of those things are so perfectly done that really, I hope no one's thinking about them when they watch the movie.
Yeah, very much so. The one thing I just sort of want to throw in for any LA listeners, I was in your fair city a couple weeks ago, went to the Academy Museum, and they have a Godfather exhibit up right now that is like astonishing. That's like props and costumes, sketches, all that sort of stuff. But also, really, for my money, the highlight of the thing is like the full scale, the Don's office is like in like the fucking room.
Set, like they recreated the set.
Yeah.
Whoa. Yeah. I might have to go to LA just to see. I love things like that. I love recreations.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Oh, that sounds great. I was going to ask if they have the horse's head, but the study.
They have the horse's head? Yeah. They got both for you out there, Judy. All right. For the next randomly chosen movie on your list, I'm going to turn it over to my co-host, Mike. Mike, what do you want to hear about?
I want to talk about Last Tango in Paris.
I don't know what to call you.
I don't have a name.
You want to know my name?
No, I don't. I don't want to know your name. You don't have a name, and I don't have a name either. No names here. Not one name.
You're crazy.
Maybe I am, but I don't want to know anything about you. I don't want to know where you live or where you come from. I want to know nothing, nothing, nothing. You understand?
You scared me.
Nothing. You and I are going to meet here without knowing anything that goes on outside here.
The point that you made about you know, Brando and these two things, I want to follow up on, because he was famously such a pain in the fucking ass on The Godfather, and like not learning his lines, you know, and just sort of, I mean, that's, those stories are so famous that when I'm watching Last Tango in Paris, I'm like, did he just improvise this whole movie? Like, what? How did they make this movie?
It seems like it, right? It seems like he improvised.
It does. It seems like he sort of like had an American's understanding of French, and they just went and rocked with it.
A pretty
so
bad
is
one.
That?
Yeah, and I think, but I do think, I mean, I'll be honest, I don't think Last Tango's a great, great, great movie in the same way that some of the other ones are, but I think it's an excellent movie, and I think it does actually look gorgeous, and that is one of the reasons I love it. I think it's, you know, who doesn't want to live in that apartment? If you're a woman, you probably want to look like and dress like Maria Schneider. I mean, she's incredible. I don't know if anybody wants to be Marlon Brando in that movie, but it's, you know, it just, the music is great. And it's just, it is a feast for the eyes and the ear. And that's a big part of its appeal, I think, that it's so beautiful and stylish. And I hope that, you know, that's also part of the point of the movie, is that all of those things don't really matter if your wife commits suicide, or if you're about to, you know, enter a bourgeois marriage that seems like fun, but probably isn't going to be in 5 years. I also think the movie is a lot about the play between reality and cinema, obviously, since Jean-Pierre Léaud is making a movie about his fiance during the movie. But Marlon Brando, when she asks him to talk about himself, even though he has that rule of, you know, don't talk about it. He lists all the parts that he played in movies, right? Like someone says he was a rebel in South America, and he was a ship's captain, and he was a journalist in Japan, and all these things that he played, but I don't think he ever did any of them. So that, I think it was a lot easier for him to just talk about himself, really, like his memories of milking the cow and the shit on his shoes when he went to school. I think it was improvised. I mean, it seems that way. So, but I think that gives us that effect of that Bertolucci wanted.
Well, because everything else about the movie is such a Bertolucci film. It's so controlled.
Yes.
It's so, you know, it's sort of everything in its place. The angles are all proper. You know, it's everything else about it is so controlled that it sort of creates an environment where he can just be fucking miserable and just walk around being miserable in this movie. Yeah. And it actually works. It actually, it actually sort of, like, because Conformist is one of my favorite movies ever.
Yeah.
And that just, like, you know, the tension in the shots and the way that the sort of the filmmaking and the acting sort of play together in Conformist, it feels like they're actually bumping up against each other in this movie, but in a way that totally complements instead of sort of. I had actually never seen Tango before. Well, I watched it for this episode and I really.
Really?
Because I love Conformist so much, I stopped watching his movies at some point. And I know that's a very nothing can be as good. You know?
I get it. Well, if I really. Like some of my favorite movies, I will never rewatch them because I don't want to spoil that first great moment when I saw them. I mean, I am crazy about like that about some movies, but it's interesting because what you just said just kind of goes back to what I was saying before, which is that balance of the controlled versus the uncontrolled, and which may or may not have something to do with the story of Last Tango, but it's definitely a good way to make a movie.
Mike, your instincts are right. He did do quite a lot of improvisation, much more than he typically did or Bertolucci typically allowed, and that was a big part of the sort of collaboration and some of the friction too, was that I think he kind of felt like Bertolucci got more out of him than he was comfortable revealing, which I think is very interesting. But keep in mind too, like, you know, before this year, for about 6 years before this year, like Marlon Brando was considered over, was like, you know, Coppola had to like get him to do a screen test and take a huge pay cut and so forth for Godfather.
Wow.
And then he ends up having this incredible year, wins Best Actor, fucking kills it. And then he's Marlon Brando again. Judy, I want to hear about the movie you picked 72 for that wasn't The Godfather. I want to hear about Fat City.
Can I buy a cup of coffee?
Yeah.
Yesterday is dead and gone.
Life makes a beeline for the drain.
And tomorrow's out of sight.
In 4 days, I'm going to be 30.
And it's bad to be alone.
There are some women that love you for yourself. But that doesn't last long.
Help me make it through the night.
That City is, I love that movie so much, but I understand that this is like a personal fixation of mine, that other people might like it or they might not like it, but they might. And I can't say that I have a particularly good reason to say why it's my favorite movie of that year and one of my favorite movies, but a lot of it does have to do with the crafts of the movie, because it's designed. I mean, I actually didn't realize this because I never think about who designed a movie or who shot a movie unless I happen to know. But yes, Richard Silbert, once again, who has designed some of my favorite looking movies, designed Fat City. And I think it's really the best movie John Huston directed, but obviously I'm a 70s person. So it's, the opening of that movie, I think, is one of the best openings ever for any movie. And I have others I could list that are among my favorites, but it's, it opens with, Help Me Make It Through the Night, instrumental version. And it's a montage of what look like real people. They don't look like actors dressed as real people, and the city of Stockton, the wrong side of the tracks, city of Stockton, and people who are down and out and down on their luck. And it is so moving to me, and also just sets the tone for the movie so beautifully, and sets the world. Like, it really gives you the reality of the world that the movie is about to take place in. And then the actors don't disappoint. I mean, I think Stacy Keach is incredible in the movie, and all the actors are, but I just rewatched it and I was like, what? Like, he went to Yale? Like, Stacy Keach went to Yale? Like, I mean, he went to Yale, but you would never, like, that's acting, okay? Because you fully believe that he is a drunk like down on his luck, ex-boxer who, you know, just can't get it together and never will. And it's, you know, it's a story about not being human to me. And it's, and, you know, we could all be where he is. We could all, you know, it's so easy. It's so easy to cross that border, I guess, between managing and not managing, you know. And yeah. I don't know if you guys agree, but I've often had fantasies about, like, why bother? Why not just go be a junkie, you know? And I'm not, I don't mean this seriously, but there's a part of me that's like, yeah, it'd be so easy just to stop trying to engage with the world and just be, you know, like, sort of, I don't want to say sink to the bottom, but I think another Kris Kristofferson song, which is me and Bobby McGee, where freedom is having nothing left to lose. I mean, that is freedom, you know, because we all deal with these real life problems of paying our rent or our mortgage or whatever, and making sure we're up on our health insurance and all these things that take up so much time and are not fun or rewarding in any way. And then there's, mm-hmm. you know, if you have a job you don't like, that's not so great either. And just like, is everyone tempted to just say, fuck it, like, I'm going to stop, you know? So mm-hmm. that movie, that brings that out. That movie brings that out in me, you know, all of those yeah. thoughts and feelings, along with a lot of empathy for the characters in the movie. And again, just perfectly, perfectly crafted. I'd say one of the most perfectly crafted movies I've ever seen. So that's my aesthetic.
The thing that blew my mind that I didn't know about until a few months ago, friend of the show, Sean Burns, a previous yeah. guest, wrote a piece about it at Crooked Marquee, a site that I edited.
Really?
Wrote a huge thing about Fat City. And what I didn't realize was that, like, this was very much Houston's comeback movie. Like, after the Misfits had fallen apart in the early yeah. 60s, he did this exile in Ireland. He was making kind of not great movies. He's doing things yeah. like The Bible and stuff like that. And this was his first, like, Hollywood movie in about a decade. And the fact that he just, like, roared back in with a movie that has that new Hollywood feel, that feels yes. like Bogdanovich yeah. or Friedkin or yeah. one of these young bucks could have made it. And Houston's just coming in here like, fuck you, I made The Maltese Falcon and I can make this too.
Yeah,
you know?
It's actually amazing that he did that.
Yeah.
And I admire him so much for that, because you think of that, definitely that new Hollywood is a young man's game, you know? And when someone like does something again, like when, Werner Herzog made Bad Lieutenant, and in Port of Call, New Orleans, which I sure. love. But I'm like, yeah. this is a young guy's movie. How did he make this yeah. movie? You know, and that's always so impressive. So, yeah, it's like another reason.
It's one of my favorite examples of that idea that, like, those, you know, there was a time when to be a director meant, you know, swapping genres all the time.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
you know, sort of the idea of, like, finding the notes of this director that show up in a cowboy movie and a detective movie and, you know, and then yeah. and he's, you know, sort of had done that. You know, yeah. had been through several sort of different styles, then was, you know, there's that famous story about, you know, somebody was making fun of Shakespeare because he couldn't write, like, the 5-act thing, right? And he was like, fuck you, and wrote the best one ever made. It's one of those kind of like, oh, you think I fucking can't? All yeah. right. You know.
I love that. Yeah. That's, yeah. and I don't know if he made any good movies after Fat City. Like, did he?
Oh, yeah.
Pritzy's Honor.
Pritzy's Honor, baby. I mean, he was making the dead with, like, a fucking, you know, a breathing machine strapped to his face. He's like, I'm dying on set. I don't give a shit.
That's a good way to go.
Yes, indeed. All right, Mike, what is the fourth film we're going to talk about?
Okay, I want to hear about Heartbreak Kid.
Neil Simon wrote it. Elaine May directed it. The Heartbreak Kid.
It's just plain old-fashioned corny lingo, sir. I have fallen head over heels with your Kelly here. It just, you know, it didn't take me long to make up my mind. One good look did it, actually.
I said you're lying in my spot.
Oh, you are this terrific girl! You are this terrific girl!
Now, there is a slight complication. I happen to be a newlywed.
This is not my favorite movie.
Oh. What's wrong with you?
Well, agree. Right. That's what I want you to tell me. That's what I want to find out. Okay. I want to find out what's wrong with me.
Not your favorite movie. Yeah. It's not your favorite movie, and?
Well, it's like Cybill Shepherd is great. Like, there's a lot of great things about it. There's a lot of great performances. It's not, but it's, I was sort of like, whoa, this is a top five? Like, hit me with, I want to see why this is like a top five.
I think that movie, well, first of all, it has a lot of serious aspects to it, and it's social commentary and existential crisis and, you know, like all these movies. Like every single movie I picked, I was like, I'm not really in the mood to rewatch this right now. You know? Like, I want to watch some shitty British mystery on BritBox. But, you know, these movies are a downer, but, you know, like the movies of that time were. And also the movies of that time, and not so much in The Heartbreak Kid, but are examining, like, real people and people who are living more in the margins of society. And The Heartbreak Kid is just about like an average guy, an average girl. They get married way too fast. I think to have sex basically. And so they could buy birth control. Cause maybe, you know, that illegal. Yeah. They made this movie. And it's a mistake, obviously. He thinks so. But it's hilarious. I mean, maybe you have to be like a Jew from New York, like I am, to find it so hilarious, but I've seen it so many times. I just saw it at the Metrograph, I think, like a few months ago.
Nice.
And I was like, yeah, this movie holds up. Like, it's just, it's almost like Rocky Horror Picture Show to me. Like, I know what's going to happen. I know that he's going to tell her, like, when he got the pecan pie, and, you know, I know egg salad on her mouth, so gross, and, you know, and another, what does she say? Another 50 or 60 years or another 60 years. Like when she keeps talking about you're just going to have to put up with it for another 50 or 60 years. I mean, like over and over. See, she's not like, you can see why he is like, what the fuck did I do? You know? And he's no great catch either, you know? And he's not. It's like, these are two very like, in certain ways, unappealing people, both of them, or just regular people. You can see it either. If you're not married to her, she's fine. So, and maybe he's fine too. He doesn't behave so fine, but so he meets Dream Girl. And, you know, I'd say we all wonder really, how the hell did he get her? You know, like really, like he went out to Minnesota and he manages somehow. And it's just, you know, he's exotic to her. She's never seen anyone like him. And then that's not enough either, right? He's at the wedding reception, and it's really a movie about dissatisfaction. What does life mean, you know? And it's a deep movie. It just
that's the key.
In a comedic way. Yeah. So now you like it now?
You've shown me the key, which is finding some sympathy for Grodin, which is like finding a connection to his experience and having some empathy for him. Whereas I'm just, you know, I'm sort of watching the movie like, this fucking guy, I just don't know what to do. This guy's fucking hopeless. But I think that's an interesting point.
Ending. It's not a happy ending. Right. It's like as soon as he gets her, he's miserable again. And, so that's what's so great about the movie.
I agree. I fucking love The Heartbreak Kid. Mike has just like a lifelong aversion to cringe comedy. and I do think that like when we're talking about, you know, about cringe comedy, like this is a formative text. This is like
interesting. This is doing it. It's not my favorite genre, and I never even thought of this movie that way, but you're right. But it is great, and it is a form. It's the Bible, really. So.
Absolutely. Yeah. Elaine May. And then what I also love about it is that it's written by Neil Simon, and it has got way more piss and vinegar than a typical Neil Simon script. And I'm not anti-Neil Simon.
No, I know.
I love his stuff.
No, but
he's he's a, you know, he's a joke machine, and this is not a joke machine movie.
At all.
And Elaine May's direction is just like, is peerless. I think it's truly a movie that maybe does not work if you have a dude directing that dude's script about this terrible dude, you know?
Right, I think that was Really, yeah, cheap. And she cast her daughter too. Let's not forget that.
Brilliantly, God! Yeah, but like, yeah. how much therapy do you have to go to? Your mom cast.
And then
your
mom cast you in that role. Gave me the leading role in a movie, and you'd think that'd be a good thing. But I just wanted to be Sybil Shepherd. I'm sure she did. I'm sure she wanted to be Sybil Shepherd. But I was thinking I don't think there is a single joke in the movie. Like, not a haha joke. You know,
right?
Like,
not
a single one, and that is unusual. Yeah. You're right. So I just learned something too.
There we go. All right. The last film in our top five, John Borman's Deliverance.
These are the men. Nothing very unusual about them. Suburban guys like you or your neighbor. Nothing very unusual about them until they decided to spend one weekend canoeing down the Cahulawasi River. John Borman's film of James Dickey's explosive best-selling novel.
Yeah, man, I rewatched that today, and
oh shit!
Yeah, so that you know, I had to medicate after that. But on the other hand, much as I think it's an important movie, and it's definitely a memorable movie, especially certain parts of it. But I hadn't realized how layered it was in terms of depth and what it's about and subject matter and man's relationship to other men and to the earth. And very, the early 70s was a big time for environmentalism. So it's not surprising that there would be a movie that has some of that in it. But it's really very forward thinking in so many ways about man's relationship to the environment. And something I've studied a bit and in the 90s. And it was really interesting. Like, is nature there for us to just take advantage of it? Obviously, that's what these guys think. Like, yeah, let's ride that river one more time, you know, before it's late. And I think a really, really deep movie told in a way that might not seem so deep. I don't know how to describe it because it's not really a genre movie, but, you know, and by the way, I never read about movies. So all of these really original thoughts are just from my brain.
No. It's not a genre movie, but it has genre elements. It has the boys' adventure, the action, you know, the forest, the river and all of that's riding the rapids. There's horror movie stuff in it, obviously. There's almost Friday the 13th type shit in there almost, but I think above all, and I mean, and I don't know, this is why I know how easy it is to romanticize the 70s, but you know, the idea that like mainstream studio movies were willing to like, yes, this has genre elements, this has exploitable elements. You can put together a trailer that sells this movie, but this is ultimately a movie about masculinity, about toxic masculinity.
Yeah.
You know, 45 years before anybody's using that phrase.
Completely. Yeah. It is. And it's also a movie about man, and I don't mean masculine, like I don't mean the male gender, but about man's relationship to the environment, which is also, it was timely at the time, but looks even more timely now. And and both of those things. And it's also fascinating because I didn't really realize it until today, because I was thinking about it instead of just watching, that it changes protagonists like halfway through the movie.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, and that doesn't happen too often. So that was really, so that was, it's pretty well done. And
there's an interesting element too of how the people are part of the environment, the people who are already there.
Yeah.
You know, the people, right? Yeah. There's a little bit of a like colonist, nativist, you know, sort of thing happening, even though like everybody's white. And you know, so like that's a different sort of a take on that, but that's definitely a part of it. And the idea that there are people here who are a part of this land, and if you want to come ride the river, you're going to have to deal with them, get rid of them. You have to have a plan for this sort of 100%. Element of the environment that you don't know anything about and that is dangerous to you.
It's dangerous. Right? And it's such, so deals with that I mean, most of the time, I mean, I think there's a few moments where you're like, this is just like pushing it a little bit for the audience, you know, but it's in the beginning when they're the dueling banjos and the old man starts clog dancing. And it's this really fantastic moment. And they're like, you know, smirking about it, you know, and that's like, that's like, don't smirk so quickly, you guys.
Yeah.
You know, you know, these people belong here and you don't, and you're going to find out what that means. And it is very much about that, which is, I think, one of its best things about the movie, and the performances are great too, of course.
Yeah. No, you know, again, like, yeah, this got, you know, major studio release, big budget,
yeah,
major stars, came out, huge hit. Dueling Banjos became a radio hit. Like, America had Deliverance Fever.
That's insane, though, when you think about it.
Yeah.
Oh, and then can I say one more thing? Another thing I love about the movie is that it's about Southerners in, like, city Southerners in the rural,
yes,
South. It's not about, yes, Northerners and versus the South. You know, it's two different cultures within what Northerners think of as one culture. And I think,
yeah,
that's such a key ingredient of it. So key.
Yeah.
Like, it would have been much worse movie without that.
I agree 100%. All right. Thank you, Judy, for that first rate top five list. And now a word from our sponsor.
This episode is brought to you by Mubi, a curated streaming service dedicated to elevating great cinema from around the globe.
From iconic directors to emerging auteurs, there is always something new to discover.
With Mubi, each and every film is hand-selected, so you can explore the best of cinema streaming anytime, anywhere.
And while they currently have some 1972 movies streaming in the U.S., I am going to cheat a little, because Score from 1974 came up on the browse page, and we already did 1974, but I still want to recommend Score, which is directed by Radley Metzger, who we've mentioned on the show before, or maybe just in the after show. This was his last not quite hardcore movie before he started making hardcore movies in the 70s and took on the Henry Paris name.
It sure feels like it's gonna go hardcore at a couple of points, though.
It's really on the hinge between the soft and the hardcore, but it's a terrific sex comedy, drama, relationship movie. You think it's setting up, you know, it's like a swingers movie, basically. This couple meets another couple, and they make a little bet with each other that they can seduce the other couple, but they don't pair off in the way that they usually pair off in movies such as these. The young woman goes after the younger woman, and the young man goes after the younger man, and it keeps things very spicy and unpredictable. And Radley Metzger, like, was a legit filmmaker. He knew how to put a movie together. He knew how to put a scene together. He could click, click, click. His compositions are outstanding. Score is really terrific. So if you'd like to watch a movie that's really well done and is also pretty hot, I would recommend Score, currently streaming in the U.S. from Mubi. Mike?
I would recommend checking out Lake of Dracula from 1971,
all right,
which is a Japanese horror film. Obviously, there's lots of great Japanese movies coming out, you know, for at least the whole generation before this.
Mm-hmm.
But this movie is a vampire movie, which, mm-hmm, is a distinctly sort of Western European, you know, there's no samurais. It's cool as shit. Lake of Dracula.
Nice. All right. Well, you can try Mubi free for 30 days at Mubi.com/a very good year.
That's Mubi.com/a very good year for a whole month of great cinema for free.
That's right. Free, baby. All right. Let's find out what films were winning trophies and making money in 1972. Here's Mike with awards and box office.
Sell out with me. Oh, yeah. Sell out with me tonight.
All right. As it should be. Best Picture, Best Actor to Marlon Brando, Best Adapted Screenplay to Coppola and Mario Puzo for The Godfather.
No lies detected, no complaints, carry on.
Very good, yep.
Best Director to Bob Fosse, Best Actress to Liza Minnelli, and Best Supporting Actor to Joel Grey for Cabaret.
That Cabaret is fucking good. Cabaret
it is,
holds
and I was
up.
On the fence about. I kind of now think maybe Cabaret, Last Tango. I'm not sure which would be the one. I mean, that could change in my head. But yeah, my only problem with Cabaret is Liza Minnelli. So.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Not a fan.
I know. I like her. I think she's good. I don't think she's sexy enough in it.
Yeah, fascinating. Okay, yeah, I'll go with that. I'll go with that. All right.
Yeah. But I love her. I don't want her to feel bad. I mean, it's, you know.
Yeah. Best supporting actress went to Eileen Heckart for Butterflies Are Free. I've never seen that one.
Me either.
It's a good one. It's a good one.
Yeah.
Best original screenplay to Jeremy Larner for The Candidate.
Ooh,
oh,
The Candidate.
That's
is
a good movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good, yeah. Good, tight script. Yeah.
Yeah.
Best foreign film went to The Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie.
God, I love The Discreet Charm. I fucking love it. I love it. Oh, that dirty old man and his dirty movies. God bless
him. Yeah, I saw that movie when I was like 14 and I didn't understand any of it. So I never revisited it. So.
It's worth a look. It's worth a look.
Your perspective will have changed over the years, I imagine. There'll be some jokes you didn't get the first time, if jokes is the right word for it. Yeah. Other significant award winners. The Golden Globe for Best Actress went to Liv Ullmann for The Immigrants.
Which I shamefully have not seen.
I don't know if I've seen or not. But that's so funny because the Golden Globes was really schlocky back then, right? But they gave a good award. Like, yeah.
Well, if you want to hear really schlocky, stand by.
In fact, that organization gave the award for Best Supporting Actress to Shelley Winters for The Poseidon Adventure.
So there we go.
There we go.
The
wow.
get you an awards-giving body that can do both, I guess. Yes.
Pasolini won the Golden Bear at Venice for The Canterbury Tales.
Very good. Hats off, Pasolini. Okay.
Yeah, fine.
And there was a split award for the Palme d'Or at Cannes between The Working Class Goes to Heaven and The Matai Affair.
I've not seen either of them. I just love the title, The Working Class Goes to Heaven. It's just a real good title.
It's a French movie. It's a great title. And it's very 72, I think. Very 1972.
Yes, it is. Yes, indeed it is. All right, Mike, what did the domestic box office top 10 for 1972 look like? This is a rich and varied list, let me tell you.
This is a very fascinating list. Number 10, Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Sex But Were Afraid to Ask.
It was a title. Got him in.
Got him in. No matter even how you feel about Woody Allen, not one of his best movies.
Not one of his best movies. No, I mean, not at all. And he made some... I'm saying, me, Judy Becker, my opinion only, he made some great movies in that time period.
He did.
Not a great one. Yeah.
Not little too blackout sketch scattershot for me. Yep.
Yeah. Also, considering all the great, like, you want to call them exploitation? We call them adult? Like, that movie needed to be a lot fucking dirtier to come out in 1972. That movie should have come out really 5 years before. Yeah.
It's true.
Number 9, Lady Sings the Blues.
Hell yes. Richard Pryor should have been nominated for Best Supporting Actor for Lady Sings the Blues. I will shout it from the highest mountaintop.
Number 8 was The Getaway.
Oh, interesting. Huh.
Peckinpah's big comeback picture. Like, Getaway was a big hit when he really needed one, apparently. Yeah.
I didn't know it was a big hit. That's interesting.
It was. Yeah.
Number 7, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this is the only time That a movie that is this adult has made the top 10 list, right? Was Deep Throat.
Deep Throat.
Really?
Yeah, that's even, number 7 for the year.
Domestic for the year.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And honestly, that's reported income. Like, I've done the reading on that movie, and a lot of the money that movie made just like went straight into like suitcases that mob guys picked up.
So it made a lot more.
It made a lot more.
Might
than
have been
that,
number one.
Might have very well
I've
been,
seen
yes.
it listed as high as number 4. I've seen it on top 10 of the year lists as high as number 4. But when they place it that high, there's always a little like asterisk that's like, we don't actually know.
Right.
the deep throat asterisk.
Really interesting. Yeah, really interesting.
Yeah.
Just a little asterisk hanging at the end like a little tonsil. Anyway.
Yeah. That's there funny. Should be another one, by the way, that says Lovelace made like $50 off that fucking movie. Number 6, the aforementioned and much loved Cabaret.
Very good.
Lots of people liked that movie in 72. Number 5 was Jeremiah Johnson.
That I was a huge, huge box office success. People love their Redford, man.
And I've never seen it, so I can't.
Oh, it's really good. Yeah. It's very good. Yeah. Yeah. Good double feature with Deliverance, actually.
Which was number 4.
There you go.
On our list.
No.
Yep.
Number 3, What's Up, Doc?
Oh, Judy, do you like What's Up, Doc by Peter Bogdanovich?
No, I can't watch it. I can't. She annoys me too much. So.
Wow.
Yeah, I know.
Wow.
And I have
Bab
friends.
Slander on the pod. Wow.
You know what? I have my husband and a very good friend of mine. They both love that when they're like, you've got to watch it again. You got to see. And I tried. I gave it 10 minutes. I mean, that was it for me. Sorry.
Wow.
And I'm sorry, Peter, right. You know, because I love Peter Bogdanovich also, but no.
Mm-hmm. Yep. All right.
Number two, because these things always do well. Poseidon Adventure.
Yeah.
Yes, they always do big, well. Yes. And
big, huge smash. There you
especially
go.
Especially Shelley Winters. Yeah.
Yep.
People were having a hard life in 1972. They didn't always want to watch Marlon Brando mope around Paris, right?
<City. Yeah>.
And number one, cue the hat trick effect, Bailey.
Oh, would you believe it?
You are witnessing something quite spectacular.
Complete the hat-trick!
Crazy, just crazy. Remarkable hat-trick.
Beautiful, just beautiful.
Y'all ready for this?
All right, yay!
The Godfather.
The Godfather at number one. Judy, congratulations. Occasionally we have a guest that pulls the very good year hat-trick, which is when we have a film that was number one at the box office, best picture, and on their top five list. And you have achieved this rare feat with The Godfather. Congratulations on your excellent taste.
What do I get?
Absolutely nothing.
You just got it. It's our hearty congratulations. And there's a sound effect that will play if you actually listen when it comes out.
And it's a rare year in general, right? When
a great
movie is great and gets those things too. So.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
Yes. By a guest that is a titan of the industry. So congratulations.
Yeah. Someday that might happen.
All right, Judy, you ready to do a lightning round?
Yeah. I'm looking forward to this.
All right. I'm going to barrel you through. Say as little or as much as you want.
Okay. I watched the example. So I'm like, she must be a professional comedian. I can't compete with that.
If you got something to say about it, say it and say it quick. If you got nothing to say, just pass. I got a nice long list here. A lot of good shit. Here we go. 5 minutes on the big clock, Mike, and Chow Manhattan.
I love that movie because she talks about how, I don't even remember, she started the culture that the redneck hippie belongs to, and I love that.
Boxcar Bertha from a young man named Martin Scorsese.
Not his best work, but a great, great opening as he continues with Mean Streets and Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore.
The King of Marvin Gardens.
I have never seen it, but I should
have. It's pretty good. Hot Rock.
A movie I loved as a kid. I loved that movie. I had a crush on Paul Sand, and it was very funny, and I don't want to rewatch it because I might hate it now, so.
I love that out of that cast, you had the crush on Paul Sand.
I know.
Bruce Dern in Silent Running.
I've never seen it, but I'd like to.
Slaughterhouse-Five.
Never seen it. Pass, whatever.
Alfred Hitchcock's Frenzy.
Oh, Frenzy. It's actually a really good movie, you know? I'm not giving enough credit. Hitchcock did a good job with that.
Eric Rohmer's Chloe in the Afternoon.
I like it, you know, but I was having trouble distinguishing it from many other Rohmer movies of that period, so I just couldn't bring it to the top five or even the top eight.
Francois Truffaut's Two English Girls.
Again, liked it a lot, but not his best, in my opinion. Oh, I love Truffaut, but not the one I remember.
Fellini's Roma.
Eh.
Bergman's Cries and Whispers. Herbert Ross's, not Woody Allen's, Play It Again, Sam.
Oh, yeah. It's like cute, right? It's like a cute concept movie. Yeah. Humphrey Bogart and Woody Allen and all of that.
Another Neil Simon script, Last of the Red Hot Lovers.
Never seen it.
Two juicy Gene Hackman performances in Prime Cut and Cisco Pike.
Prime Cut is quite a movie. And
it is.
I've seen it several times. It's hard to find for a while. Cisco Pike, I've never seen, and now I want to see it because Gene Hackman's great.
Great movie.
Gene Hackman in a supporting villainous role opposite leading man Kris Kristofferson. Cisco Pike is
great. And I love Kris Kristofferson. So, yeah. Yeah, who's a Rhodes Scholar.
Yes, indeed. Two starring Michael Caine, Pulp and Sleuth.
Wait, what was the first one? Pulp? Pulp?
Pulp.
Like P-U-L-P? Was
his reunion with his Get Carter director.
Never saw, I pass on that one. Sleuth, I mean, it's very, actually, it's a good, it's like a Columbo episode. It's a good movie,
it is.
Right? Yeah.
It is. Yeah. Wes Craven's Last House on the Left.
Great movie.
It's a scary, very scary, scary movie. Even now, I think it's scary.
Brian De Palma's Sisters.
Sisters should have been in my top five, Michael. And Bailey. Bailey, it was in your top five, right? I just saw Sisters for the first time like last year. And it's really,
holy shit.
Yeah, no, I really liked it a lot. I think it's a movie that hasn't sunk in yet. So it didn't make, you know, it didn't surface to my top, but really good movie.
That totally scans. Paul Morrissey's Heat was released in 1972.
I can't remember which one that is. I mean, I just don't remember it. I've seen it.
Fair. Yeah. Fritz the Cat, the X-rated cartoon.
Great little film.
Never seen it. I've read some of those comics, but yeah. But yeah.
Robert Altman's Images.
Damn it, that's with Susanna York. Is that
yes.
with Susanna York? Yeah.
And yes.
When I saw it, another one I didn't understand, you know, but I'd like to see that again. I'm ready for a second viewing of Images and a double feature with Discreet Charm of the Bourgeoisie.
There we go.
Yeah.
Dario Argento's Four Flies on Grey Velvet.
I have never seen that movie, but I love the title.
It's a great title.
It's a great title.
Recently discussed on the Video Archives podcast, Ozana's Raid.
Pass.
Sam Peckinpah's No, Ozana's Raid is killer. It's a great Vietnam era Western. Like that very specific brutal
Western.
Ass. Very much. Sam Peckinpah's other 1972 movie, Junior Bonner.
Never heard of it.
Okay. I'm going to give you a choice here. Do you want more Westerns and cop movies or do you want some blaxploitation movies?
Well, I like blaxploitation movies. I'm probably better at the Western. I probably have seen more of the Westerns and cops movies, if any. So let's go with those.
Okay. Joe Kidd from director John Sturges and star Clint Eastwood.
But not that one.
George C. Scott in The New Centurions.
I don't remember it. I'm not doing so well.
You're doing great. Burt Reynolds in Fuzz.
That's past.
How's about Gordon Parks's Shaft's Big Score?
Well, the score for all the Shaft movies is great. So. Wait, did Gordon Parks
direct
that? Gordon Parks, a photographer?
Did the first two Shaft movies. Yes.
I didn't know that. See?
Yeah.
Wow, that's really fascinating. So I got to go see those again.
And then Gordon Parks Jr. directed 1972's Superfly.
Yes. So that should have been on a list, maybe. My list. Yeah.
All right. And that is our lightning round. That is our 5 minutes. Judy Becker. You did great. Yeah. You did great. It's a rich and varied year. And I made it through about half of this list.
Yeah.
So thank you for that. Now we're going to throw it to our friend W. Axel Foley for a quick PSA.
Head on over to your favorite podcasting app. Give us a star, a rate, a review. Give us a written review and tell us that you love us, because that's what lets people know that we're here.
All right, Judy, where can people keep track of you and your work? Are you on social media? Do you have a website? Do you bow out? What's your move?
I'm on Instagram. I don't have a website. And my Instagram name is Becker Design 2000.
Outstanding.
Name, Becker Design 2000. And I'm going to tell you why, because it was in the year 2000 that I became a production designer. So
there we go. You know what?
Also.
Instagram is the social media platform that a production designer is going to shine on. So
yeah,
stay off the other ones.
Social media, but it's like I have probably 6,000 posts on Instagram. So now it's like a visual diary of my life. So I have to keep
beautiful. Beautiful. That sounds like a first-rate follow, folks. And while you're following her, cruise on over to Metrograph.com. Get tickets to the Filmcraft series. Again, that starts on June 3rd, but they'll be running those double features a few times in the days that follow. Meanwhile, I am Fun City Cinema on Instagram, Jason-Bailey on Letterboxd, where you can find, under my list, the top fives for every episode of the show. Mike, where can people follow you?
I am at BrainwashedLib on Twitter.
And I should mention that we are now on Substack, averygoodyear.substack.com, where paid subscribers get bonus episodes, bonus writing, and much, much more. Mike, before we go, what is your favorite movie of 1972?
My favorite movie of 1972 is a documentary called Marjo, which is a combination of the names Mary and Joseph, about a kid who was born into like a fire and brimstone, hellfire preaching community, revival
it's
preachers.
A great movie. Yeah.
Oh my I've God, I love that movie so much. Yeah, and he, great. You know, it starts off with stuff of, you know, there's footage of him in the 50s and 60s as a little kid out preaching this fire and brimstone. And then in the 70s as a full grown and clearly broke adult, he decides to go and become a fire and brimstone preacher again and start raising monies at revivals. But there's all these behind the scenes shots, and there's pictures of him in the hotel counting money and clowning the whole thing. And it's a fucking amazing movie. And I'm not huge on remakes, but there needs to be somebody needs to make that movie now with like the guy who becomes the new Ben Shapiro, but he's like in on the fucking joke the whole time. The point is that, you know, the audience is still sort of predictable and malleable in a way that I really think that movie could be made again every fucking year. And it probably wouldn't make any difference, but it would be good movies. So Marjo, my favorite movie, documentary from 1972. How about you, Bailey?
My favorite of the year, aside from The Godfather, which predictable, boring, basic bitch, white dude thing is my favorite movie, yada, yada, yada. Yeah. But I'm going to take the opportunity to recommend Seek Out Across 110th Street, which is a terrific combination of sort of like the New York grimy post-French Connection cop crime picture and a sort of like the bleakest blaxploitation movie imaginable. Incredible Yaphet Kotto performance, incredible Anthony Quinn work as just like the dirtiest fucking cop imaginable. And Paul Benjamin, one of the corner men from Do the Right Thing, will break your heart as the sort of criminal at the center of the thing, who's one of the most desperate people you've ever seen in a motion picture. And also just an amazing Bobby Womack title song, great score. It's just a really, really good movie. Pops up on Amazon Prime periodically. There's a really good Kino Lorber Blu-ray of it. Pick it up. It's highly recommended.
You've been telling people to watch this movie for 25 years, dude. Or I don't, maybe not that long, but it feels like it to me.
It sounds amazing.
And,
amazing.
you're
I've seen Marjo. This is that's amazing.
No, it's the title song in Jackie Brown. And so I'm like, well, what song is this? And then you go look into, you hear the song, and then you go, well, this is part of a movie. Let's go see this movie. And yes, I've been begging people to watch it ever since.
You want to like your friend's favorite movies, you know? You don't want to be like, I saw that. It was all right. This was one where you know, you told me to watch this. We watched it together. And like, there was no, I didn't have to fake the funk at the end of Across 110th Street. That movie lives up.
Nice. All right. Thank you again, Judy Becker, for coming on the show.
Thank you, guys. So much fun. I love doing it. Thank you. It's a great concept for a show, too. Love it.
Thanks so much. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Jason.
And thank you for listening.
Sweet and clear. It was a very good year.